Good morning, everyone. Test, test, test. Can anyone hear me? You shouldn't be on sugar. You are jacked up right now. I have this on. Oh, test, test, test. We should have test. Good morning, everyone. Regardless of technology, it is good to be together this morning. Though I'm irritable. Are you irritable? It's six degrees when I got up and went to church. You've got sugar for me. Who else has sugar for me? It was sunny, but then it was like wicked cold. I was out and about yesterday. I'm like, why does it have to be so windy? It's going to be tricky. I don't know if we're going to be able... You're going to have to give me some feedback, like, just turn the microphone off. It. But spring is taking a while to really get its hooks in us, and eventually it'll be here. And then I want to say hello on behalf of us in church. You can't see us, but we're grateful you're here. We're glad you're jumping online and joining us. We have a really strong online presence. It's like a whole third church. The numbers are really good. So thank you for joining us, finding us, enduring us. Praise God on your worship this morning. You know, God's blessing. Okay, this morning, this week was a difficult sermon for me to write. I'm struggling to bring it. The Christian message is backwards. The good news, the gospel, what Christians believe, how we're supposed to live, is really a backwards message to what the world says. In the world, we're supposed to be number one, the best, the first, to be strongest, king of the hill. You get your power and you hold on to it for dear life. You have a preference for something? Fight for it. That is not the way of Christ. That's not the Christian life. We're supposed to let go of our egos. We're supposed to submit our wills to God's priorities. That's not a fun sermon to bring. But it's the truth. And so that is the new sermon, the new cup that we're drinking from today, the cup of discipleship. And that is the message we will wrestle with as we progress this morning. And I have a few announcements for us. Let's see. I want to remind you that as you contribute any funds to the Bridge Pantry, that March is the month that they have donors that will double the giving. They will double the giving. So if you give something in March, it will be doubled. It's a great month to give to the Bridge Pantry. So I want you to be mindful of that. I want to also encourage you to make plans to attend Dent's fundraiser, Fry Bread fundraiser. Oh, I know I'm gonna be like first in line. And it's also the citywide garage sale. I think we're ready to go back to garage sales, right? Like, I think that'll just get us out. But I'd encourage you to go and contribute to Dent for their fry bread. I think that would be a lovely exchange. Dent has a lovely Yamaha, blonde Yamaha piano they never use. Nothing wrong with it. And if you would like to donate something to get a piano, you just have to be willing to pick it up and haul it. Yeah. But seriously, there's absolutely nothing wrong with it. And they're trying to kind of, we use the organ. We're just pleased with that. So I wanted to let you know we had a lovely time at our game night on Wednesday. We had a lovely time. And our conference, I think this is interesting. Our conference at the same time is encouraging us. All the churches are struggling. They're like, just do small, simple, sustainable things that help people feel grounded in joy again and relationship and connection. And I think that's, part of what we did Wednesday night is just a simple, sustainable way of being together. But we had to lay some ground rules. I didn't think I'd have to say this. But you have to let your pastor win at least one game. Oh, I won't come back. I just think you guys are rude. Yeah, I'm the youngest. Be nice to the youngest. I'm used to it. No, actually, when you're the youngest, you learn how to play 5 times smarter because that's the only way you can beat your siblings. Yeah, apparently you guys are smarter than my siblings were. So I'm sure it'll come around again. I just encourage you to kind of make that something you participate in. It's a lot of fun. We had a lot of fun. Did you have fun, Margie, learning a new game and then winning and beating me? It was like a complete sting. I like to teach new people so that when I win, I feel good. But it didn't work out. Taught you a new game, you won. That was miserable. All right. Enough of silliness. Let us open in prayer. Dear Lord, you are the suffering servant that is described in Isaiah. And you offer us a cup to drink from this morning that is hard. A cup that speaks of service, suffering, humbling ourselves, choosing you over ourselves, choosing to serve others above our own interests, hobbies, commitments. Is this really the path of life? Is this really abundant life that you promise us? Transform our hearts into servants' hearts to live and to serve your priorities. Transform our hearts into servants' hearts to genuinely serve others with love and generosity. Come, Holy Spirit, come. We pray that your grace continues to fill our lives so that we can be your servants, doing your work in your way for your glory. And Lord, as we come to this moment of silence, as we center ourselves and settle into this opportunity to worship you, we pray that you would help us to quiet ourselves, help us to open ourselves to you and the work that you want to do in us. We hold our cups, and we are eager to drink from them as you help us drink from them, as you give us grace to drink. We're willing to drink the cup of discipleship. We just ask that you would replenish us and renew us by your Spirit. Empower us to do this. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Please stand if you're able for the call to worship. What do we want this morning? Jesus calls us to be servants and humbly follow him. Jesus calls us to greatness by different roads. Success through humble service, abundance by emptying ourselves for God's glory.
Jesus, thou knowest not what you want for us. Give us abundant grace to follow you through selfless service, all for your glory. Amen.
Please remain standing for hymn number 370, Victory in Jesus, verses 1, 2, and 3.
Seated. As we begin our time of joys and concerns, again, I'm just going to kick it off with a prayer for Ukraine. So let us pray. Lord, we pray for godly wisdom for Ukrainian government officials. Paul reminds us in your word to us, O God, in 1 Timothy, how and for whom we are to pray. And Paul says, I urge you then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made ready for all people, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. So So, Lord, we do that. We pray for Zelensky. We pray your strength and peace. We pray for Putin. We pray your peace for him, Lord God, a change of heart, a desire for the war and hostilities to end, and for those, for all of those who are displaced and on the move. God, we pray that you would provide water and food and shelter. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Are there some joys and concerns that we might lift up to God as we pray for one another? Lord, we thank you that we are on the journey with Derek and Alyssa, and it's hard to hear that the way things are supposed to be working for his internal organs are just not working. And I can't even imagine how difficult that must be. It's just something I don't think about. And so I thank you, Lord, that we can be made aware of his suffering and that we as a family can lift him up. And so we do that, Lord. We ask that you would be with Derek. We pray a miracle. We pray that you would touch his internal organs and help them rest and help them go back into the place they're supposed to be and that they would function in the way that they're supposed to function. God, we pray that you would touch his body and help that come about. Strengthen him. Strengthen his spirit. Even as he's been on a long journey, God, and I can't even imagine how he gets up each day and faces each day. So I pray that you would encourage him and sustain him, help him have a sense of your presence with him, your love for him, your delight in him. And I pray that that would strengthen his spirit as he's still battling. And thank you, God, that we can be in prayer. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we lift up Chris to you, the man who has skills that are wanted, and the ability to speak Russian, I'm sure, is just important. So, Lord, we lift up Chris. We pray that you'd protect his life, guide his steps, open up ways for his gifts and abilities to be leveraged to the utmost to help bring the war to an end. Lord, in your mercy.
One of my quilting ladies passed away on Friday. I'd like to ask for prayers for the Klot family.
Lord, we lift up the Klot family, friends and neighbors, everyone who knew the woman who has passed away. God, we pray that you would pour out your grace. We pray that you would pour out your comfort. We pray that you would give them peace as they struggle with the loss. And help them, God, put their trust in you. As they put their trust in you, may that encourage them to know that one day they can be reunited with her. It does not have to be forever separation, but they can be reunited with her. So I pray for family and friends and neighbors, help them pull together, help them be gentle with themselves and encouraging and supportive of one another as they go through this season of grief. Lord, in your mercy.
Prayers for the Geigel family back in Mandan. Their father, grandfather, was killed in a hit and run in a parking lot.
Geigel?
Yeah.
Okay.
Lord, we lift up the Geigel family to you in Mandan. Those tragedies just hit so hard. God, we ask that you would be with the family and neighbors and those who witnessed it and the person who did it. Lord, we ask for your grace to be a river, bringing healing and forgiveness and the ability to grieve and know your peace and to put their trust in you again. Hold this family together. Guide them as they grieve. be with the community as they're just reeling from this kind of traumatic accident. May people see the glimpses of grace that you often give during these difficult times. May people see them and say them out loud and lean on you and celebrate their faith in you. Lord, in your mercy, allow me to wrap up in prayer. Lord, we pray for both of our churches. I still believe, Lord God, that we are grieving in the people that we have lost. And so we ask that you would continue to comfort us and help us to grieve, help us to be reconnected to one another. And we're looking forward to spring. We're looking forward to warm weather. And but just be with us. I still think that is a very real need that we have in both our churches. And as the pandemic recedes for now, I don't know if it's coming back or what's going to happen. As the war rages, as we wait for you to do a good work in our midst, Lord God, help us grieve, help us reconnect, help us to reach out for one another, be in prayer for one another. Help us to remain open to you and the ways that you want to be at work in our midst and in our lives. Lead us, Good Shepherd. Help us to continue in the ministries that we're a part of. Help us dream up new ministries. Lord, you're always doing something new in our midst. And sometimes we're not paying attention. So we pray that you would give us eyes to see. Open our eyes. Give us eyes to see how you are at work so that we can join you and be a part of the life that you want to give us. Help us to be a part of that, Lord God. Guide us in that. And we pray these things. And all of God's children said, amen. Please rise as we turn to our next hymn together. Seated. Allow me to pray for the offering. If you'd like to grab these, that would be great. Thank you. Dear God, we seek to serve you. Lord, in this moment, our faith is shared in tangible ways as we receive this offering. Knowing that serving you means serving our neighbors and our family and people near and people across the world. May the gifts that we give this morning and the lives that we live and the way that we serve point people to you. Amen.
prayer of illumination. Holy God, we seek your help to understand, to perceive truth, to be open to you today. We ask for light to dawn on our darkened minds and give us insight into your word to us and your spoken word to us. Amen. I'll be reading from the scripture of Matthew chapter 20, verses 20 through 28. Then the mother of Zebedee's son came to Jesus with her sons and, kneeling down, asked a favor of him. "What is it you want?" he asked. She said, "Grant the one of these two sons of mine may sit at your right and the other at your left in your kingdom." "You don't know what you are asking," Jesus said to them. "Can you drink the cup I am going to drink?" "We can," they answered. Jesus said to them, "You will indeed drink from my cup, but to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared by my Father." When the ten heard about this, they were with the two brothers. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles' lord is over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated.
I learned how to lead a small group when I was in InterVarsity Christian Fellowship in college and had a lot of opportunities to lead a small group. And after I graduated and moved down to the cities and started attending a new church, I thought, well, hey, that's what I can do. I can lead a small group. So I started leading a small group, and I don't know what we called ourselves, but we were kind of all in the same life stage. It was after college, but before responsibilities of family. I don't know what that life stage is called. I'm not going to go there, but we met weekly, we read scripture, we were trying to figure out how do we orient our lives around these values that Jesus is teaching and preaching and sharing and living in the scriptures. And it was pretty simple, and that's what we were doing. And at one point, I don't know how this happened, but we decided, hey, let's do a spiritual gifts assessment. I don't know, maybe that was the time when they were big, you know, that used to be a big deal. So we took the assessment, everybody in the group took the assessment. I have no idea why I got all the copies, but I was looking through them because I was curious, and I noticed something interesting about our small group, that we had a lot of people in the small group that tested as gifted in servant, as a servant in service. And I thought, well, let's test that. Let's test that theory. So I researched an opportunity to feed the hungry, and I shared it with the group, and they seemed interested. I was skeptical because we had never done this before. This is a brand new thing, but we all agreed to give it a try. So the event, the evening of the event came, and it started out slowly. And we arrived early. They walked us through the process. We started emptying the semi-truck of food and putting it in bags and getting ready for people to come. And I thought, this isn't going to work. This is so slow. I wanted it to be encouraging for people. I wanted it to be confirming of their spiritual gifts. And it's like, it's not working. Oh, no, it's not working. But then things just took off. People started streaming into the park from all different directions. And the small group transformed right before my eyes, just instantly. They became animated. And they became the hands and the feet and the face of Christ. And I was transf- fixed as I watched hungry people, vulnerable in their hunger, come, and I watched my friends gracious and kindly responding to the need. I don't think I've seen the face of Jesus so powerfully up until that point. So that experience for me revealed the face of Christ really powerfully to me. And I was humbled. And I watched them come alive in ways that I had never seen them come alive. And they were serving, and they were smiling, and they were sweating. And, you know, we weren't experts. We were just willing. We were simply just trying to follow the way of Christ that was being laid out in Scripture. And we took to me, it seemed like a very small step, but that event changed me. It changed us individually, and it changed us as a small group. Our desire to serve others exponentially just exploded, and it was cemented in our hearts and in the life of that group from then on. We were always asking each other, what's next? Who's next? How else could we bring our whole selves? How could we bring our group to be a blessing, to provide for people? And after that day, we consistently found a variety of stuff to do. I mean, we heard about it, we'd bring it to the group, we'd go, oh, sounds great. One of them, I don't know how we said yes to this, but there was a missionary group, missionaries, who were trying to get buggies for their, people they knew. And the buggies they had were flimsy and weren't working, so they needed to purchase, like, super industrial, tough baby buggies. No idea. I didn't know that they came in, like, industrial versions. And we were like, sure, that sounds great. And we collected money over the weeks, and they told us a certain amount to buy a certain amount of buggies, and we were like, go for it. We did it. We never saw the results, but we enjoyed the thinking about it. And one day we served our church. Our church at that time used to meet in a gym. And so they had tremendous setup and tear down responsibilities every Sunday. So we decided, hey, we'll do the tear down. And our group had the fastest tear down time of any other, just saying. That's what motivated me, right? I mean, the servants wanted to serve, and I was like, faster, faster, come on, we can do it. I still think about that evening of feeding the hungry and the way the dots were being connected in our lives as we did this and watching my friends come alive to Jesus' way of life. And we grew deeper. We grew in our understanding that following Jesus actually physically means following Jesus. It's not all up here. And we learned that it wasn't just an event, it was a lifestyle. Maybe it worked because all seven of us were looking for things that we could do, ways to serve. I found it easier to just hang out with my friends instead of trying to individually serve. I felt safer, and so that gave me confidence. And I think I mentioned it was fun, and my friends were having so much fun. And I'm surprised that every single time I'm in a situation in which I serve, I'm surprised by how much fun it is. Like, every single time I'm surprised at the fun. Every single time. I don't know why. We became known as the small group that wants to serve. And we were trying to bring all of our energy to bear on meeting needs. And we had some good experiences. Maybe it was our youthful idealism. Maybe it was the fact that we had more energy than we knew what to do with. But I keep thinking about that summer evening. That experience is nothing like the tension we find in the text for us this morning. There's an incredible amount of tension and discord in our story this morning. The disciples were jockeying for position, elbowing for power, trying to figure out who's boss and gets to call the shots. In many cultures, and ours included, often great emphasis is placed on being first, being the greatest, being the best, being the boss. I just couldn't help but keep thinking and hearing this phrase inside of my head. You're not the boss of me. And I don't know if I said that a lot as a kid. I don't remember. Maybe. Probably. And we would never say that out loud today as adults. But sometimes that spirit is still very much alive in our hearts. It's too embarrassing to say it out loud, but it might still live inside us. People, including Christians, will work compulsively to set up their dominance and hold on to power for dear life. There's a lot of different reasons. Sometimes it can be fear. Change is hard. Nobody likes change. And so that can be a reason. I get that. I do that. And then believing that we should have the power, that's what I love, that people are like, I'm like, why do you think you should have all the power? And it's, of course I should have all the power. Could be based on a variety of reasons. Sometimes it's wealth. I've experienced in different churches, people who have a lot of money, they want the power. It can be thinking you're the smartest person in the room. I heard that over the years. And then I think I was reading something recently, and the person who was talking about this reminded us, but that person has forgotten that God is in the room. Yeah. It could be status. It could be talent. It could be seniority or time with the organization. I've heard this in churches. That you might hear someone say, my parents went here or my grandparents went here. And sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes what they mean by that, what they're implying by that, is that my voice should have more power. It should have more influence than the person who's only been here 10 years. And Christians are the best. We don't even have to take classes or training to be the best at sounding humble and self-effacing and still vying for power at the same time. And yet Jesus is not impressed with that. He's not impressed with that kind of posturing for power. Jesus doesn't respect it. And he doesn't stay silent because he isn't Minnesotan. Instead, Jesus emphasized the importance of serving others. And talking about humility, and essentially proclaims a reversal of our culture that we live in. The worldly message that plagued their culture and still plagues our culture. In just a few verses before this passage, Jesus is teaching his disciples. He's always teaching his disciples about what the kingdom is like. And so just a few verses before this whole incident, Jesus is again describing the nature of the kingdom. This is the kingdom of God. This is it. And he says, so the last will be first and the first will be last. Jesus is not about power and control. Those who position themselves first will be last in God's eyes and in God's kingdom, because God sees our hearts and he knows our motives. We can't fool God. It's ironic, actually, because Jesus is first. He was born the Son of God. He is God. But he lived and served and ministered like he was the last. And he was always trying to teach the better way, the more excellent way of love. He took on the very nature of a servant. He humbled himself. And he had to continually reinforce these truths, these values, keep teaching his disciples who were not getting it. Can you imagine? Jesus has just taught about the kingdom, and they vie for power in the next exchange. The next, it's like, are you listening? And it can be difficult to listen and to stay focused on Jesus' message when the voices of the world and our culture so loudly tell us something that's opposite. It's easy to get wrapped up in the world's perspective. But we can learn, we can listen, we can be taught, we can listen to Jesus' perspective about power and control. Jesus had all the power, but he submitted it to the Father's will. was always showing us to teach us. So, okay, let's go into the text. So first we have the mother of James and John, the sons of Zebedee. She's making a gutsy and bold plea on behalf of her grown sons. It's not heartless. I mean, she really, I think, legitimately is concerned about her kids and their future. But it is amiss, because she wants to make sure that they are successful and powerful in the ways of the way their culture defines success and power, which is not the way of a disciple of Jesus. And James and John had been following Jesus. And James and John were on board with this. Totally on board. It wasn't that they're like, Mom, we talked about this, don't do this. No, they knew what she was going to say, and they were like willing. She comes and kneels and asks Jesus to assign her sons to be second in power and glory to Jesus. And I love Jesus' response. He responds with a statement and a question. You don't know what you are asking, and can you drink the cup I'm going to drink? And they're like, yeah, we can do that, yes. They didn't understand. They didn't understand. Jesus is showing the kind of glory that he's going to experience, and therefore his disciples will experience. It's not the same kind of glory the world values. This is the cup that we are not eager to drink from if we're smart. Remember last week's sermon? And if you do, God bless you. Right? I don't remember what I ate yesterday, let alone last week. But if you can remember last week's sermon about the Lord is my cup, the Lord is my portion, he's my lot in life, that's the cup we should be eager to drink from. Here Jesus begins to explain the cup of discipleship, walking with God. And Jesus' cup, drinking from this cup, will involve great suffering. So we need to put this story in a little bit of context that I hope helps even heighten the learning that we can get from it, because the disciples were completely out to lunch and clueless. Jesus is leading his disciples to Jerusalem for the Passover. And Jesus knows that in Jerusalem, during the Passover, he's going to be betrayed. And he's going to be arrested, and there's going to be this mock trial, and he's going to be tortured, and he's going to be put to death. And he had just finished telling his disciples this idea of service, lowering and humbling of self does not guarantee that you will not suffer. I mean, he's just laid it out. Later in Matthew chapter 26, the night he is betrayed, Jesus is in the garden with his disciples. His disciples keep falling asleep. They can't stay awake. And Jesus is praying in agony, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me." And then these fateful words, "Yet not my will, but yours be done." Can you imagine if he had never said that? But he did. He said, "Not my will, but yours be done," the cup of discipleship. This is the cup he is referring to with James and John. But they don't understand. They don't get it. And if I am to be honest, most of the time I don't get drinking from this cup either. Because why does following Jesus have to mean you will experience suffering at some time, at some point? Why is that part and parcel of following Jesus? Why does it have to be? Because he could protect us. He has the power to do that, but he obviously chooses not to, because he didn't protect his son. He didn't buffer all the bad things that his son experienced. Jesus is asking his disciples to drink. And maybe I do understand enough And I just don't want to drink this cup. The word disciple means both a student of someone and to be an adherent or follower of someone. It involves both learning and relationship. Discipleship, learning and relationship. To be a disciple of Jesus, therefore, means to share in the love and salvation of God, the good stuff, and to share in Jesus' suffering and humility, this side of heaven. And some of that is expressed in servant leadership. Signing up to be a disciple means opening oneself to the same kind of persecution and suffering Jesus had. And it requires us to be servants. So the rest of the disciples, when they hear about this, are super angry, right? Who wouldn't be? Wow, I wish I had thought of that. Like, maybe if I had thought of that and asked sooner, then I could be the one to sit right next to Jesus. So neither James and John nor the disciples were getting this, and Jesus had to do more teaching. And he confronts not only James and John, but he confronts the disciples yet again of their worldly understanding of leadership, power, and greatness. And if the disciples want to follow Jesus, they must lead by serving others, just as Jesus did. It might mean leading more than you ever wanted to for God's glory. It might mean leading less than you know you're capable of doing if that's what's best for the group. One way to look at this, being first, being the best, being the greatest, being the boss, it's not a goal of discipleship. Rather, just as the Trinity is interdependent and mutual, we too are relational beings. We're created to be relational beings, and out of our interdependence, we're all cared to call for one another and serve one another, not as if we're better than others, but in our awareness of our need. We need each other. We're absolutely dependent and needing of one another. And we belong to each other. That's the love of the Spirit, connecting us, building us into a fellowship, worshiping God, serving God. And it's a beautiful experience to be a part of that. I think that's part of what I was experiencing in that small group. And the kingdom words that I think would describe what Jesus is trying to communicate, trying to teach, help us catch a vision for and embrace, would be words like teamwork and partnership. Our small group, we weren't fighting or backbiting. Maybe it's because we just didn't know enough about life and we just were trying to figure out life. But maybe we found some unity and peace because we were trying to seek meeting the needs of others, and we kind of always kept that before us. When we give something up for Lent, if you do, sometimes when we give something up for Lent, we're just thinking about ourselves. It's just an individual thought that we're like, oh, what am I going to do, you know? So maybe we could flip that. As we're still in the season of Lent, maybe we could flip the thinking on that and we ask ourselves the question, what might Jesus be calling us? Maybe he might be calling us to give up ourselves for Lent, give up our preferences and our busyness, and what would it look like for us to set aside our personal comfort and our preferences and hobbies, and what would it look like to drink this cup of discipleship? What is Jesus asking of us? And can we even do it? I think the struggle is real. I'm not going to say it's super easy. It's not. Can we even do it? But I came across this slide, Rosie the Riveter. And you know I have a love for Rosie the Riveter. I've got this mug. And Rosie believes that we can do it. So maybe that's what we can hold on to, is that we can drink that cup of discipleship. If we do it together, it makes it a little bit easier. So we can do it. We can drink that cup. Amen. Please rise as we turn to our final two hymns together. Now receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen and amen.
Thank you.
You're like a mountain. Were you ever that tall?
Pardon?
Were you ever that tall as Dave?
No, I only shrunk about 2 inches.
You're a tall guy.